Okay, great. Peter, I think without any further ado, I'm gonna hand over to you. I don't know if you want to use the slides that we have, or whether you would prefer to.
That would be very useful. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. And good morning, or afternoon, or evening, midnight, whatever it is, everyone, and welcome to the 2024 GRLI Annual General Meeting. As we've come to imagine, our all-gathering momentum sessions. This annual gathering provides a unique opportunity for partners and associates to reflect on the past year's learning, to coordinate for the year ahead, and to collaboratively shape GRLI's strategic direction. As chair, it is both a privilege and a responsibility to open today's session by reflecting on our shared journey and setting the tone for the day and the year ahead. We gather at a critical time for humanity and for the planet, an era of profound challenges, but also unprecedented opportunities. In such a moment, GRLI's work to foster globally responsible leadership and practice is more urgent and impactful than ever. In 2024, that impact has continued to grow, shaped by the unique contributions of everyone in this community. This AGM serves as both a checkpoint and as a springboard, a moment to align on how we can best contribute to the transformation urgently needed in leadership, in education, and in society. To frame this reflection, I want to revisit the five pathways that we introduced in 2020, which have been instrumental in guiding GRLI's work. And I feel awfully alone in cyberspace right now, so I can't see you, and I hope you can hear what I'm saying. First, our essential purpose. At the heart of GRLI is a fundamental and thought-provoking question. What is global responsibility? And from that question flows even more questions. What does it look like in practice and in leadership? How do we cultivate and develop it in ourselves and in others? Our essential purpose is to hold these questions and to uncover and build pathways that can embody viable responses. GRLI does not claim to have all the answers, but we are unwavering in our commitment to asking the right questions and to exploring them with openness and curiosity. As many of you know, 2030 is our symbolic sunset date, a line in the sand that prompts us to measure whether our work is complete. Until then, we remain dedicated to this inquiry, sharing a rich tapestry of experiences, learnings, and partnerships as evidence of collective impact. And this is not linear work. It requires courage to explore new paths, patience to hold space for emergent insights, and humility to learn from the inevitable dead ends. It is a dynamic inquiry, one in which today's discussions and reflections are a vital part. Now we turn to governance, what I like to describe as taking care of the vehicle that carries us forward. The GRLI is unique in its relational governance model, which is built on partnership, trust, and shared accountability. Our board stewards the legal and financial integrity of the foundation, while the Guardian Group safeguards vision, mission, and ethos on behalf of this council of partners. This dual structure allows us to remain agile, transparent, and values-driven. Exemplary governance is not just about responsibility. It reflects who we are as a global responsibility entity. It shapes how we approach relationships, partnerships, and decisions. Today, we'll also hear about the evolution of guardianship, a testament to this ethos in action. Engagement is the lifeblood of GRLI. This pathway is about sustaining and deepening relationships among the individuals, institutions, and networks that energize and advance our work. From founding and strategic partners to institutional allies and individual associates, our community is bound by shared vision. But these relationships go beyond transactional exchanges. They are deeply relational. through initiatives like the Dean's and Director's Cohort and crucial conversations, we create spaces where collaboration transforms into shared ownership and belonging. Today's AGM exemplifies this ethos, a gathering where everyone's voice matters and dialogues drive actions. Beyond internal relationships, GRLI increasingly acts as a connector, a catalyst within the broader ecosystem of networks and initiatives dedicated to global responsibility. In a crowded and complex landscape, GRLI serves as a sense maker, aligning efforts and fostering collective impact over self-interest. This pathway reflects our commitment to amplifying the work of others, focusing on what we can achieve together rather than merely building the GRLI brand. And now something came up on the screen. Might have been the GRLI brand. We are part of something much larger than ourselves, and by aligning with others, we contribute to systemic transformation that extends far beyond our immediate ecosystem. Finally, GRLI is at its core, an inquiry, a space to explore and learn from the most challenging questions we face. From foundational contributions like whole person learning to initiatives such as Be the Tipping Point, we embrace the uncertainty that comes with a meaningful exchange and change. This pathway calls us to remain curious, courageous, and committed to learning from both success and failure. It is through this spirit of inquiry that GRLI continues to innovate and uncover the new approaches to global responsibility. As we embark on today's agenda, I invite each of you to bring your full selves into this space. Let us reflect on where we've been, dream boldly about where we can go, and commit to the work needed to get there. The GRLI is not just a foundation, it's a movement, a collaborative inquiry into what is possible when we lead with responsibility and act with purpose. Thank you for being part of this journey, and thank you for your unwavering commitment to making a difference. Let's begin.
Thank you very much, Peter, for opening, and also to everyone who's joined since we've started the call. You are very welcome. So, from my side, our AGM is open, and as we've heard, this AGM is about gathering momentum. And of course, for those of you who know me, I love extending that metaphor to cycling. I did manage to get a few kilometers in on gravel bike this morning, which was just the medicine I needed. Momentum is essential in cycling. I see Anna Karanen, who's a fellow cyclist, smile. But so is coordination, and so is balance, and so is knowing the terrain. And just as cyclists in a peloton or a pack work together to maintain the rhythm, the direction, this meeting is an opportunity for us to synchronize and move forward with clarity and purpose. So that's where the idea of GUTS comes in. And it stands for getting up to speed. And this is not a new phenomenon in the GRLI context, but we are at a point in our evolution where perhaps we need to start thinking a little bit differently about how we get everyone up to speed. I'm just going to give a little bit of context on that, and I have an invite. As I said, it's a long-standing tradition in the GRLI gatherings. I think if we meet in person, it can take a full morning or more to share, especially with those who are joining the community for the first time, in a more interactive way, the history, the guiding principles, the ways of working. And it's really about ensuring that everyone, whether it's a long-standing partner or a new associate, is aligned with GRLI's why, how, and what. And as GRLI evolves, so too we believe the GUTS needs to evolve. We're increasingly operating in a globally distributed and asynchronous way. We're engaging across multiple platforms and networks and initiatives. And at the same time, there is a need to get existing and new partners and associates up to speed and involved. So the invite is twofold. Firstly, and I'm going to ask Darija, if you wouldn't mind maybe just cutting and pasting the links, because I don't want to take up the screen with PowerPoint. But firstly, we've been working on a GUTS dashboard or a space. Now, we did circulate this to everyone who registered for the meeting, but you may not have had a chance to look at it. For those of you that have already seen it and that have already provided feedback on the GUTS space, we thank you. The aim is to create a convenient and scalable resource for understanding GRLI's work. So in other words, we want to provide a dynamic and live overview of our history and our guiding principles, the various ways in which you can connect to other partners and associates or initiatives, and of course, all the various pathways of our work where you can take initiative or convene under the GRLI banner. So Darija has posted the link in the chat. That's a prototype that we built on Airtable. We're not going to be gathering detailed feedback today, but we will be following up in coming weeks to ensure that we have your input on how we evolve the GUTS. We've also been in discussions with groups working on virtual reality learning spaces or sharing spaces to look at whether perhaps we're situated in there. But your insights will help us ensure that we maintain a GUTS space that meets the needs of the community and serves as a platform for collaboration and alignment. But the second part of the invitation, I think, is perhaps the more important one today, and that's about connecting here and now. You've already heard from Peter. You've now heard more than enough from me. Now, ahead of the AGM meeting, many of you provided input on your recent learning, your ambitions for the coming year, your reflections on our mode of travel and our direction of travel. And all of that is available on a dashboard. And again, Darija, if you wouldn't mind just cutting and pasting the link in the chat if you haven't done so already. But all of that feedback that we've gathered to date is live on Airtable. And I encourage you to reference that during the course of today's discussion. If you haven't yet filled it out, please feel free to do so, and you will have more chance to do that in the coming week. But I want to emphasize one particular element of that, and that is the scattered and gathered concept, which we introduced, I think, about a year and a half ago. So that's a section in the survey where you can indicate which in-person events you are thinking of participating in, and which the GRLI can then support with leveraging for initiative gatherings or community gatherings. As an independent foundation for public benefit, our initiatives are driven by you, our partners and our associates. So your input into where we need, what we work on, how we travel is absolutely critical. So I think that's the second part of the invite, is ensure that you familiarize yourself with that and provide that feedback. And I think with that, we decided we will keep our first check-in, our kind of interactive check-in for this morning, very simple. It's around what. Okay, and I think here I might just put up a slide. I just want to see if I've got it here. So the first check-in, I can just quickly do that. That was just the link to the dashboard, which you have in the chat. So we're going to take a few minutes. We have our breakout room set up in groups of approximately four people. Our aim here is, with this first check-in, is just to gain a deeper level of understanding about our direction of travel, but as represented by those of us who are on the call today. And I should also mention at this point that, of course, this is session one. We have 40 registrants for this afternoon. So hopefully we will be able to weave in terms of the two sessions over the course of the coming weeks in some video format or report. So we're suggesting a me to we check-in format, which is when you get into the breakout room, you do a brief round of introductions. We are trying to ensure that you have a reasonable coverage of people that know GRLI well, or maybe people that are a little bit new, with some regional and geographic dispersion. You can take turns then for each person to reflect out loud on one of the questions below. And as I said, it's around what brings me here today. So that's more of a me perspective. or maybe you want to go a level deeper than that. What is at the core of our presence here today? That's more of a we perspective. And of course, when we come back into plenary, we'll hold a brief moment just to hear whether there's anything emerging from this opening check-in that will be useful for all of us to hear before we get on to some of the business around governance and so forth. Please, once you come back into the plenary, please paste your notes, your comments, your reflections and summaries into the chat so that we have that on record. Okay, I think with that, Darija, are we set to go? Okay, perfect. We will see you back here. How long are you opening the rooms for, Darija?
10 minutes.
Okay, so it's a brief check-in.
Do we want more?
It's a brief check-in just to get a sense of who all's here and what brings us here. It was a very rapid check-in, Dale. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, my request is I was typing away in the chat, and before I got a chance to send it, I ended up back in this room, and now I don't know where my chat went.
Oh, my. Okay.
Did I lose it? Can it be retrieved, or have I logged it?
I think breakout chats are, unless you hit enter, I don't think it's stored.
Oh, lovely. I thought I was doing such a good job, too.
Oh, sorry, Dale.
Now I'm going to have to depend on my team.
We are going to hold just a few minutes just to hear whether there are any kind of burning kind of questions or insights that have emerged from the chat. So Dale, since you have the mic and you've lost your notes, would you be prepared to take a quick stab at just giving us some shot of what's come up?
So, and with the hopes that my group will chime in if I miss some things. And I really felt good about the notes I took. Oh. So I think we all introduced ourselves, and I think the one thing that became clear and is probably characteristic of the other groups is there's some newcomers, and then other people have been affiliated with GLRI for a long time. So those who are new, how do we engage? How is GLRI different? What are ways to engage in more meaningful action-oriented perspectives? We also talked thematically around the urgency in us collaborating and doing something, particularly given the barriers of geopolitics, which have been problematic, particularly from some of us who are coming from my country, where we saw the direction very disturbing, particularly as you look at how it's correlated with those who were college educated, and yet there's a big gap between the educated and the uneducated. And related to that, we talked about elitism around these issues and not valuing the expertise around issues of a planet's viability. So the importance for global responsibility and really thinking about this in the global context and being global citizens is so critical at this particular time. There's urgency because of these issues. So how might we work together across our networks when a lot of different groups are doing different things? How do we make those connections? And then what can we do as a group that may be a little bit differently that captures urgency? And also from the positive side, we talked about our hopes as educators, educating a generation that does have purpose, that does want to see the planet survive and cares deeply around sustainability. Group, did I miss anything?
That was perfect, Dale. Thank you so much. You captured it beautifully. Thank you.
Thanks, Dale, for giving us a sec. Let's just have a quick check. Is there any other group? And we're not going to be hearing from everybody. There's no obligation. But is there any other group that had a very maybe concise or particular question that emerged from your opening check-in? And I've placed what I hope is a reasonable representation of some questions that emerged from ours into the chat. Feel free to add to that. Just checking if there's anyone else who wanted to.
I think we should ping Morris.
Yeah. I was just going to say our group had a really interesting conversation about the future of business and business models. And we talked a little bit about the cooperatives. And Morris actually has started a new program in that, which I thought was really very interesting. But also global leadership and where is it? And there's an apparent lack of it. And so as a group, how can we actually come together to help to influence some change and growth in that space? Morris, did you want to mention briefly what your school's doing? It sounds really interesting.
Well, as I mentioned in the chat, we've launched the UK's only graduate certificate in cooperative education, basically executive education for cooperative leaders, which is important if you believe in a more equitable form of governance within the market economy. And we, one thing that was just came out from the discussion, I'd mentioned that it would be great to restore the sustain the collective or cooperative sustainability graduate module, which some we've never been involved, but we would like to be involved. I think that would be very important also as a model for teaching and to do something in the undergraduate level. That would be great. But I think overall, the whole group was really excited about being here and to see what we can learn, what we can contribute. And I'm happy to talk about anybody about cooperatives.
Great. Thanks, Morris. And perhaps we can do a deep dive on that in the new year if Dundee is open to hosting that. I see that there are also some feedback points being added from Olu. Thank you, Anna. And from KLU, Marianne, welcome. Glad that you're here as well. And thank you for adding that context. So we have a few kind of business items that we all, that we have on our agenda before we go into the second breakup, where I think a lot of what was flagged during this opening check-in, we'll have an opportunity to deepen the discussion on and find ways forward when we ask, so what and now what? I think we've surfaced a sense of what is in the room and how that may influence our own direction of travel. So I'm going to hand back to Peter just to take us through some board acknowledgements. And Peter, just a warning, I have added one slide, which I don't think you've seen around the committee. Which I'd be happy to take when we get to that. So let me just quickly get the slides back on.
And while you do that, perhaps I can maybe also, as a reflection on what you just did, say that I think what I heard from Dale and others was, and also some of the chat, is the management of the ecosystem is essential. That's also what would allow us to get connected and then, of course, the content of, and that was what other people was talking about. What is it that we should do together? Anyway, now I think we are ready to, for this with the slide. This is both a sad and a happy moment, I believe. It is sad in a sense because Amanda Goodmanson is leaving us, and Amanda, as is the Executive Dean of the Faculty of Business and Law in Queensland University of Technology. And she's also a human resources. She started out as a human resources practitioner. And I should have spotted that because she actually she cleverly recruited some of my best people. So from Copenhagen Business School. But apart from that, she's been a tremendously good colleague through the years and also a great contributor. GRLI. What I should also have spotted is that I think 5 years ago she started studying equestrian and equine studies and a master of animal science, which means that she's going to do something completely different after New Year. And of course, that's also a happy thing. So in our dialogue, we started discussing for reasons that only Amanda can explain sugar cooperatives. So maybe, Amanda, if you would want to say a few words as a leaving member of the board.
Thanks so much, Peter. Yeah, it's just interesting, isn't it? We're in business schools. We all come from very diverse backgrounds and different focus that we might have in our own personal lives as well. I've been at QUT for 26 years, so I was in private practice before coming into QUT, but in the agricultural industry, I'm a farmer at heart. That's my background, and I'm a sugar farmer and a cattle farmer, which probably are two things that don't go well when you start to talk about sustainability. But in fact, we're using a lot of sugar now for for energy resources, and we've got a new project at the moment which is looking at how we can use sugar as a biofuel for aircraft to reduce the pollution that comes from aircraft fuels. Yeah, it's not all bad in the sugar industry, but I'm also a member of a cooperative. So my area, my little town that I live in, we are the last cane growers cooperative in Australia that manages their own mill. And it used to be all mills were cooperatives. Now they've all been taken over by large business, and the business models have changed. And we were the very first cooperative in Australia, and now we're the very last. So I hope that I can continue growing cane and continue the sugar cane on that. That's my next focus. So I'm moving completely out of higher education, but it's been my absolute joy to have been involved with the GRLI for the entire time that I've been, almost the entire time I've been at QUT, and we've seen a lot of change, a lot of impact in our business curriculum as a consequence of this global network. So I'm very grateful for having been a part of this very incredible group of people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Amanda, for your efforts.
Thank you, Amanda.
And on another positive note, it's great to welcome Raul as a member of the board. Raul Villamarin Rodriguez is vice president at Woxsen University, and I've come to know Raul. I've known Raul considerably less than Amanda, but already he's made a great impression as a very active participant and networker at different conferences. I remember in particular, I think in Barcelona last year, or was it this year? Sometimes these things, it probably was this year, but it seems like a long time ago. But anyway, great to have Woxsen University on board and Raul on board from Woxsen. Raul and Woxsen are both extremely dynamic in the way they act, and so we have high expectations for your contributions to the board, Raul. But do you want to say a few words?
Surely, thank you so much. Though also just like you, I don't know, since I'm having two offices, one in India and one in the flight normally, which is not a very good lifestyle to have, but that is the modus operandi currently. A bit of background both about myself and the institution, in case there is not much awareness on the second part. I am a cognitive psychologist by training, not by practice, primarily because I work in the area of consumer behavior and emerging technologies. So I work a lot with energy sector, aviation sector, airport operators, as well as general transportation. Most of my time is into executive education and consultancy, besides the administrative work, which is at the university level, which keeps me entertained on the daily basis. Now, aside of that, Woxsen was originally a school of business. That's how it started, a large school of business, more than 3,000 students full-time originally, and then expanded into a university when we got approval from the government. We became a private university in the country, among the few with such investments in campus and infrastructure as well as manpower. At the moment, we are a large ecosystem. We don't just think of GRLI and any other organization only as part of the School of Business. We think of it as a large cohort of all the schools, because the good part of being a very fast-paced in university with people who want to collaborate is that all the schools come together. It helps a lot building that interdisciplinary environment as well. Consequently, we are in that trajectory. And for us, as I was narrating to my colleagues in the breakout room, for us, aspects such as ethics, responsibility, sustainability, societal welfare are not really a feel-good activity or that we have an option about, because at our end, in a country with 1.4 billion people, where it's run by farmers and it's run by agriculture, and with a generation of students which is by the year more and more entitled as it happens, we need to ensure that they get the real outcomes from the societal needs. And hence for us, both from the curriculum, the activities, as well as at the larger level of the leadership, our main focus and financial investment, as well as departmental activities, go into that societal welfare in various aspects, from women to children to different rural areas, building schools from nowhere, So things of this array is what we do as practical projects and is led by the students. And this is what we want to also advocate through the GRLI and also create that GRLI advocacy in the country. Though India is considered a country, India is huge. Considering the size of it, it's almost like a subcontinent by itself. Consequently, there is a lot of happenings around the place. And if you need any more details, of course, I'm happy to answer it anytime. Thank you so much once again.
Thank you for joining, Raul. We very much look forward to the collaboration. And with that, to you, John, I believe, right? Or to Vanessa.
Just before we go over to Vanessa, if I may, I don't think she's on the call today, although one of her colleagues is here. We just want to acknowledge the great work that Sheila Killian has been doing as a member of the audit subcommittee now since 2016, I think it was. And Sheila, I've known since we ran the Deans and Directors Cohort prototype after 2014, after the 50 plus 20 vision. And Sheila had the vision at the time also to bring a number of groups together at an event called Common Good, Common Ground, which to a large extent helped inform our ecosystem stewardship work that we're going to be discussing more today. So I just wanted to acknowledge Sheila. Sheila's retiring from, or has resigned from Limerick. As many of you may know, she's also an acknowledged fiction author. And so I believe she's got some books lined up that she's planning to write off the coast of the beautiful coast of Ireland. So just wanted to acknowledge that. And then lastly, since we've touched on that, we typically also give our partners a snapshot just in terms of our financial kind of commitments and planning for next year. This is the budget, which we will also circulate after the call for input. But it's basically, the headline is to say that we are on track in terms of meeting our budget income and expenditure for the year. As many of you will know that have been part of this, we operate a fairly steady state budget. There are no increases envisaged in terms of partner or associate contributions at this stage. And also, given current global context, although there are a huge amount of things that we would like to do next year, and we can always benefit from additional revenue streams, we are sticking with a conservative approach to ensure that the foundation remains financially stable. And of course, we'd like to also thank our audit committee, chaired by Stephanie Bryant of ASCSB, and supported by both Amanda Goodmanson as the board member, and then Sheila Killian until now as the partner representative that is not on the board, but who acts as the kind of the external audit committee member on behalf of the partnership. We will circulate this as well, but there are no surprises for this year, and hopefully none for next year, very similar to what we presented last year. I'm going to hand over to Vanessa. I don't know, Vanessa, whether you want to use a slide or whether you're okay to just say.
Just to talk, if that's okay.
Thank you.
If it is. Hi, everyone. My name's Vanessa Duckenfield, and I'm honoured to share a few words on behalf of the Guardians Group at today's AGM. As part of this slot, I'd just like to take a few moments to share some of the reflections on the role of Guardians that we've had over the last year, speak about the stewardship of the GRLI's work in general, and provide an update on the year ahead, particularly the renewal process, which is currently underway, and extend an invitation to qualifying partners to consider guardianship as part of our collective journey going forward. So just to recap for those that don't know or haven't heard before, but the current purpose of the Guardians Group is to work on behalf of the Council of Partners and with the support of the STEM and the board to uphold the vision, mission and the operating ethos of the GRLI, and to ensure that all those three elements are actively supported and acted upon and visible in the GRLI and all related activity. This is informed and guided by the following principles. So we work collaboratively and out of a peer-based approach with openness and transparency, both within the group and the community, and with a willingness to be challenged and to challenge, and freely contributing to the development of the GRLI Council of Partners. Stewarding the development of the GRLI's values and ethos are being carried forward across other platforms, events and networks in ways that do not always name or highlight the GRLI directly, but unmistakably aligned with our aspirations of realising global responsibility and leadership and practice. And our stewardship model, at least on paper, is therefore due for an update to reflect the direction of this work. So this brings me to our rationale for renewal of the Guardian Group and its terms of reference. The majority of the current Guardians are approaching the end of their terms. And whilst this would typically prompt a straightforward renewal process, the context of post-COVID and an era of the GRLI evolving and how its role has evolved in the ecosystem calls for a refresh of our broader stewardship approach. So the current terms of reference were last updated in 2017, and we don't believe they fully reflect the ways in which guardianship can enable GRLI's aspirations going forward. So to address this, the Guardian Group has agreed on the following steps to set up guardianship for the future. So the current guardians will continue to serve through to the end of 2025 or sooner, but not before we have had time together to review the terms of reference for the next phase. During this period, the guardians will work collaboratively to renew these and align our new ways, our ways of working to the evolving and new needs of what guardianship looks like for the GRLI as a whole. So we're going to be issuing a renewed call for expressions of interest from individuals who represent active GRLI partner institutions and are passionate about this approach to stewardship of the initiative, primarily to be able to shape the future and be part of that next phase of change. The selected individuals want to join as guardian elects for that first phase, working alongside our current group during the transition phase, and to shape those refreshed terms of reference and contribute to the succession planning for the next phase of evolution. In addition to that, we are piloting a co-chair model for 2025 to ensure that we have a balanced leadership, stronger coverage during the transition, and the long-term approach to succession. We haven't met face-to-face for a significant number of years due to COVID and due to the change of broader changes of how we convene across the GRLI, particularly in relation to AGMs, where we would usually have opportunities to meet face-to-face and have deeper dives on what does the government look like for the longer term. So we are going to be meeting face-to-face in early 2025 to do this work and align on the future direction, most likely sometime in March. And in London, as you may have seen from the pre-questionnaire that John sent out. So just for me today, it's just to invite all qualifying partners to consider guardianship for the long term, and to thank the guardians that have been connected and part of shaping this phase and our focus for 2025 and beyond. And I'm pleased to share we've already received an application from Paolo at Catalonia Porto, who we're glad to welcome as our first guardian elect for the next phase of our existence. Paolo, your energy, perspectives and commitment are going to be essential in shaping this next phase, as are all of the ideas, new ways of thinking and contributions of our current guardians. So in closing, these proposals are designed to position the GRLI and the guardians for a stronger, more connected future. As guardians, our role is not only to uphold the GRLI's ethos, but to enable its broader stewardship across the responsible management, education and leadership landscape. So thank you, and look forward to 2025 and the contribution that we can make together.
Thank you very much, Vanessa. And maybe just also to thank you for the work that you've been doing to help set up this transition time for the Guardian Group. And to all our Guardians, I see that a number of them are also on the call that are working on ensuring that our governance model reflects our ethos and values, and that it evolves to also reflect our changing role in the landscape. Again, the remarks that Vanessa's just shared and the process going forward will be communicated to all partners and associates. If you don't follow all of that, don't worry, we will re-communicate that. And I think it sets us up for what I guess is the second half of today's agenda. And Peter mentioned in his opening reflection that ecosystem stewardship, as we've quite cheekily called it, in other words, playing a catalytic role in connecting the wider landscape, has become very central to GRLI's work in recent years. Now, this isn't a new direction. It's been part of our DNA for a long time. And I think in our breakout this morning, Paul from Monash asked a very relevant question about, isn't there a way of consolidating all our memberships, for instance? Sorry, Paul, if I'm rephrasing that incorrectly, but the question is, where do we place our energy as institutions? Do we need to be part of absolutely everything? And I think that is definitely one very critical angle of this inquiry. But our ecosystem stewardship role is partly set up specifically to explore that. Now, at last year's AGM, we did discuss what we called turning GRLI inside out, which is really about shifting the focus from building GRLI as a brand or an institution, embedding its ethos and its principles and its ways of working into the wider ecosystem of networks, associations, and initiatives. And of course, earlier this year, as many Darija Miletic took on the role of supporting this work more directly, more hands-on. So what we're going to do now is Darija and I will just have a kind of a short conversation around this particular pathway, highlighting some of the milestones, and then that will help set up the second breakout. Darija, let's start with just hearing from you around how this pathway has been shaped.
Thanks, John. This year...
Sorry, let me just do this. I just want to spotlight both you. And there we go.
That's nice.
Okay.
Thank you. This year actually began with a deep reflection at the AACSB Dean's Conference in Barcelona that Peter and Raul also mentioned earlier. The board explored the state of business and management education, broadly speaking, and this led to partner and associate conversations, which we held in April and May around an opening question: how might business and management education collectively and with urgency address the meta crisis to help ensure well-being for all living things? So that was at the center of our conversations.
Yes, and I, if I remember correctly, there are more details on these conversations on our blog and all the themes that emerged from that. But I guess you've been very close to this. What's stood out for you in terms of the input that we received in the first half of the year?
I believe, interestingly, what stood out is that we must move beyond asking what's in it for me to asking what's in it for all of us, and talking about the shift and turning the GRLI ins out, the GRLI calls to this shift from the we, from the I to the we to the all of us, and offers a pathway. And I do believe it offers a pathway for deeper and profound collaboration. But what it is important is that this call must travel beyond GRLI itself.
I think we've often said it needs to go beyond the logo. But how do we ensure that it does that? How do we ensure that what we hold, especially as we're working towards 2030, how do we ensure that it travels? And maybe you can just share a little bit about what we've been experimenting with this year, just so people have a sense of kind of what's in the works.
Yeah, certainly. Let me mark some travel points that we have been having on our journey this year. In June, at the Association of African Business School, ABS conference, ABS annual conference in Johannesburg, GRLI provided a platform to extend this inquiry in the African context. And it didn't stop there, because we were also invited at the AACSB African Conference in Pretoria, where Yinka West, now a dean of Lagos Business School in Nigeria, with you, John, facilitated a roundtable discussion that carried the conversation forward. And it traveled from there to actually the UN High Level Political Forum side event hosted by Sulitest, where we had a dialogue with the EFMD, AACSB, the Higher Education, QS, FD, and others, with the question that was focusing around what steps might we take together to prepare for and promote a collective impact across and beyond our sector. You're muted.
That's obviously, I'm a little bit biased as a South African. It was quite symbolic that conversation was started in Joburg, Pretoria. Too often, I think initiatives such as these are overtly shaped by the global north. And as some of our colleagues on the call, especially those here in South Africa, will remind us, this is the cradle of humankind, as many would argue, ensuring that is recognized, and that also that some of the historically underrepresented voices are playing a central role in helping spark this movement, I think is quite interesting and valuable. So the momentum from those various discussions that you mentioned then, of course, enabled us to support an opportunity that emerged in August, which was what we now know as be the tipping point when we applied for the MacArthur 100 and Change grant. So maybe you can just give us a little bit of background on Be the Tipping Point.
I believe the vision for Be the Tipping Point is bold. And by 2026, we envision to have a network of 100 change makers from business schools worldwide, collaborating, experimenting, and radically transforming course content and programs to meet the demands of regenerative economy. How does it scale? From those 100, the work will cascade. The idea is for each change maker to inspire two other institutions and support them in the process of change. And those will do the same for another 200. And within a few years, we will have over 700 schools, which is more than 40% of AACSB and EFMD's combined membership, that could engage in this transformation. And then very briefly, the research shows, and why we called it also the tipping point, is achieving a 40% threshold actually creates the tipping points for systemic change and systemic transformation. And this initiative isn't just about transforming education, it's about creating the positive tipping point to counter the negative ones that we are facing globally.
And yes, that's the 100 and Change grant. Now, we did proceed into the second round, but have recently learned that we are in the final round, which means that the 100 million is no longer on offer. But we've always said that the grant is the tail of the dog, the real work of transforming business education in a radical and rapid way. In other words, wagging the dog is still up to us. And of course, the endorsements that were received from the likes of EFMD, AACSB, the African Association, PRME, RRBM, Net Impact, and others definitely shows a collective resolve within the ecosystem. You know, the question is, how do we sustain and grow this momentum and this resonance that exists in the ecosystem in a way that we now take it forward? And by the way, I see that Paul also wanted to add something. Sorry, Paul, I believe I missed your hand signal, but we'll turn it over to you in a minute. Daria, maybe you could just talk briefly before we wrap up on this in terms of how we take it forward.
Yeah, I definitely believe that sustaining requires stewarding, a coalition of networks and activating change makers and institutions that are prepared to be the tipping point. And the most important thing is that this vision relies on all of us, what we talked about from I to we to all of us. So the question we pose also potentially for the breakout rooms is how we can steward a momentum that revisits what we thought, what is being thought, how we are teaching, and why, and how can we change it rapidly and radically, and how together can we ensure the longevity and impact of this momentum.
Thanks. I'm conscious of the fact that there are a number of people that were quite close to the tipping point as well, and notably Dale, who's got a very late night there. Dale, was there anything that you wanted to add just before we go into the breakout, and also hear from Paul if he's still on the call? Oh, you're on mute, Dale.
The only thing I would add is I think that the organizations that came together to be co-PIs on the grant, and then the work that GLRI did in getting so many other organizations to sign on, that's really one of the first big signs we've had of true collaboration of networks that are all interested in the same thing. So if we don't lose that momentum and we can build on that, I certainly am making it a very important aspect of what we're doing for the International Association of Jesuit Business Schools. We'll continue to keep those two, that organization connected with GRLI and the others. Again, it's the time frame and us not being together that makes it tough. So let me just do a quick plug for a concept that we're going to be bringing to Los Angeles in 2026, same time of year that World Cup will be in Los Angeles. And we are having a world forum of faculty leaders and administrators and deans from all over the world, from the Jesuit institutions, coming together to talk about issues that are germane to GLRI. We've also offered to host a GLRI cohort at the other end of the week. And then in between, we got commitment from the World Trade Center and LA Economic Development Corp. to host a convening where we all get together with leading companies that are MNCs and the consular core, of which there are over 150 countries that are represented in LA's consulate core. Because the consular core works with World Trade Center, we're bringing all of those people together with both GLRI cohort, as well as a Deans and Directors cohort, as well as this group from IAJBS. So I think as we look down the pike of the kinds of things that can happen, that's the sort of thing that can really bring home, drive home the tipping point, and hopefully entice a lot of the schools and partners that come to these events that one week of, okay, now I'm ready to become one of the schools that becomes a change maker. So that's the vision that, boy, I think we hatched this over coffee in Cape Town, I believe. And it followed up with trying to get all the people involved. And we've got some really wonderful commitments. And I'm now in the process of trying to get some corporate sponsorship for that week so that we can help folks who may be at schools that might not have the funding to come to LA, that we can help underwrite some of that funding.
Yeah. And thank you, Dale, for helping connect the landscape in that way through your dual role at the GRLI and the IAJBS. I just want to, sorry, Paul, I missed your hand earlier. My apologies.
It wasn't, excuse the ignorance, but Vanessa was talking about guardians. And I've just joined in my role, and I wasn't sure, guardians, and I'll be frank, of what? Is it thematic? Is it reach? I'm not understanding the idea of guardians in the actual GRLI movement. And that's why I just wanted to ask, what are the guardians, and guardians of what? Excuse the ignorance, but I'm being frank.
Vanessa, do you?
I can respond. So, sorry if it wasn't clear. So guardians of our approach and our values at the heart of the GRLI. So how we work, how we live our values in everything we do across the GRLI, and how we hold the voice and the needs of the partners through the Guardian Network within the GRLI and represent that at the board. Does that help? John, I don't know if there's any more to add.
Yeah, no, thank you. I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure whether it was within the GRLI, there are sort of guardians of themes or the key points or the objectives of what GRLI, and so, okay, that's clearer. Thank you.
And maybe just to add then that I think as, and I think that's part of the discussion today, is that as the GRLI's role is evolving in this context, guardianship of the GRLI's ethos, values,
yeah, ways of making sense,
is also evolving. And that's why Vanessa was calling for participation in that renewal process. But basically, we have this dual governance, the board looking after the fiduciary lead, and then the guardians looking after the ethos, the ways of working, the principles.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, Grant, you're welcome. And thank you so much for nudging us. So I'm just looking at the timing here. Darija, I assume that we have reconfigured slightly, just in terms of reflecting the numbers. We've heard a bit of a summary now of this ecosystem stewardship work, of which Be the Tipping Point is a concrete kind of manifestation. So what we're inviting into the second breakout is an opportunity to reflect on the GRLI's evolving role in stewarding the business and management education landscape's transformation. And this may be with reference to the tipping point itself, which, as we pointed out, we're looking for 100 change makers and 100 schools globally that are prepared to radically and rapidly update their course content. But it also may be broader. So we thought about how we might shape this conversation. And I'll just quickly put this on the screen. Oh, I see. Let me just quickly put this on the screen. There we go. So you may feel, and this is just a suggestion, you may feel more aligned towards any of the following roles. The one, broadly speaking, is around stewarding the ecosystem initiatives, helping connect beyond GRLI, bringing other networks, associations, and organizations together to, whether it is about uncovering the blind spots of our collective work, whether it is about kind of deduplicating the landscape or consolidating, whatever your preferred kind of approach may be. The second is that you may say, look here, I think our school or my program could help create the tipping point. So you may identify as activating that. And of course, if you do sign up for doing that, then you're also signing up for sharing your learning with at least two other entities, so that we can then share it again with two other entities and hopefully get a proper tipping point in business and management education over the next few years. And then the third more open one is that maybe you are not specifically seeing a role in stewarding or activating, but exploring critical questions that are adjacent to this work, or perhaps alternative paths towards systemic transformation that you want to propose. Darija, could you please open the rooms, and maybe people can just take a picture of that, or we can put this in the chat.
Already put in the chat.
Oh, you've already put it in the chat. Okay, and please, Dale, don't send your notes to the or take a copy when you leave. Thank you.
If we are ready, I'm happy to open the rooms.
Please do, yeah. Please go ahead. The cruelty of being cut off halfway through a sentence. And Paul, I promise it was going to make sense.
It's awful.
I tried to be gentle with the 3-minute nudge, but yeah.
Okay. We are basically holding a space to gather any burning kind of ideas, intentions that you would like to share. Again, please use the chat so that we can capture as much of it as possible. If anyone is ready to, we use the popcorn principle. If you're ready to, if you're hot, you can pop. So please go ahead.
Before I fall asleep, I will offer a couple of quick things. We had a general conversation talking about activation, exploring, and stewarding. I think one of the unique ideas that came out of a basically question and answer from Fire and I and our group was the notion that if you were a change maker and you were activating by developing a specific new curriculum, even though the model of the tipping point is then you adopt to schools and pass the learning on, we talked about the possibility of a schools working in tandem as they are collaborating to create curriculum. Within the 100, you would partner with another school just to keep that momentum going. In other words, you're not just doing it in your school, you're doing it in tandem with a partner school. And then the two of you would then each adopt two other schools. But that provides that other support, another perspective, et cetera. And I thought that was a cool idea. I know Woxsen was sharing that they're doing it, not thinking not only curricularly, but across other areas of the university. So centers of excellence who are building new cases that could be used, taking a much more holistic perspective, thought leadership, things that could go out. Raul, I think I got most, we were cut off there at the end. And then the exploratory model is going to be much more appropriate perhaps for people that are new to GLRI and would want to find out what others are doing. So the importance perhaps of communicating as these things are happening so that people who are much newer to the GLRI get a sense of the action and the momentum that's taken off so they can figure out their entry points.
I'll do this really quickly because I know we're coming up to time, but I would just like to say that it was great in our group. We had representation across from stewarding, activating, and exploring. And I think one of the things, John, that came up was the video that was done for Be the Tipping Point, which I know wasn't necessarily could continue, but if we could share that somewhere, I think that would help some of the groups to understand a little bit more about what the idea, the concept, and who, particularly that range of an amazing range of organizations and people that were involved in that call. Thank you.
Perhaps we can play the video as we close this. It's only 90 seconds and we'll give people a sense of it, but maybe just to say that, you know, regardless of what's happened to the MacArthur Foundation application, the concept of the tipping point is what we're, you know, that's wagging the dog. That work needs to be done in any case. So we're going to continue building on it from what I hear at this stage. Any other groups or anyone else who'd like to thank you all so much for joining from Limerick. Wonderful. Maybe just before we close, any other groups that would like to share, anyone who's got some intents or initiatives, ideas, or inquiries that they want to propose?
Okay, I'll say something very quickly. If anybody's interested in cooperatives, in cooperative movement, and cooperative companies, cooperative methodologies, leadership, happy to talk to anybody and to cooperate with them.
Thanks, Morris. Anyone else who'd like to raise? We'll keep this room open, by the way. So if people, I see Morris, you've got a dash. So what I'm going to do, unless there's any other burning points to add, I just want to thank everyone for joining us today. You're most welcome to join the second session as well. That's taking place later today. It's going to be a similar format, but definitely some different faces, of course, which is wonderful. We thank you for your time and commitment to the work of the GRLI. We'll continue to communicate. Please do check your emails. And we look forward to receiving your input on the various items that were discussed today. from my side also to Daria and to Claire, and in his absence, Anders, who works with us on a weekly to daily basis, depending. Thank you very much for everything that you do. And to our board members, our guardians, our partners, our associates, and those curious individuals who are aligned to us as independent associates, thank you very much for helping shape the travel, the direction of travel of the GRLI and the way in which we work. That's that from me. I'm going to say thank you, and we're going to play this video, and then we'll be here in case anyone wants to add. So let me put that on.
Thank you, John.
Thanks, John.
The world is facing a critical challenge.
Without change, current business models will continue to destroy the nature environment and deepen social inequality.
Business education needs to equip leaders who are able to address these global crises.
Our solution?
Transform business education from the ground up.
We're recruiting change makers in 100 recognized business schools,
each supporting change makers in two other schools,
and each committed to recruiting
change makers in two other schools.
A global movement in business education dedicated to environmental and social justice.
So what's unique? We are not just changing course content. We are charting a new course.
We are not waiting for change. We are delivering change here and now.
This isn't a one-size-fits-all approach.
Every school will innovate in its own way and share what works across a global hub of knowledge and resources.
Success means a new generation of leaders
who prioritize planet and people.
We'll measure success not by profit alone,
but by positive impact they create.
We'll know we've succeeded when more than 800 business schools worldwide are actively transforming business practices.
And when business itself becomes a force for global good.
This is our chance to tip balance towards a just and sustainable future.
The time to act is now.
So that's the call to action. Thank you very much.
Thanks, John. Thanks very much. Bye.
Thanks, everyone, for joining.
Thank you all for joining.